English literature, specializing in critical theory. And the title of my channel, this channel, is Awakening Literature Film. And here I discuss how to pursue and find the truth of life and the world and the universe as a whole with literature and film. In other words, how to find it after the reading of a literary text or a film, even Hollywood blockbusters. Today, I would like to talk about the central point of Buddhism here, Mahayana Buddhism, which is popular and prevalent here in China. It's called Chan, and in Korea, it's called Sun, and in Japan, it's Zen, but mainly you Westerners know it. The issue I'd like to handle today is pointing to the truth. It's like the image of the Buddhist painting that shows the fingers pointing to the moon. It goes on that then you will become Buddha, but of course it's not literally just you'll become Buddha, but you will find yourself already a truth, already a Buddha, which is God in Christian terms, of course. It's all of these are just names. Now, in Buddhism, it means you will be aware of yourself as a Buddha or the truth already after ending listening to the teacher's teaching. But I'm not teaching you here, but I would like to just discuss how we can find that after reading Jekyll and Hyde, Mr. Jekyll and Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Jesus in the New Testament of Christian Bible says, you are God. It's written already in the book of Isaiah in the Old Testament, and you don't know that. He says that going against the people, who pushes him away to the cliff of the area, that we know you are not son of God, but son of Joseph and Mary. How can you call yourself a son of God? And he says in the book of Isaiah, God said to the prophets that if you try really the best you can to follow me and my words, then you are God. He says that. So it's the same as in what they say in Buddhism. Now, I would like to talk about the Huineng's story. Huineng is a sixth patriarch. The first patriarch was Dharma. Dharma was an Indian. He was an Indian, and he went to China. And in China, the Buddhism was already popular, but he came there with new trends of Buddhism and became the first patriarch. And then there were second, third, fourth, fifth, and then sixth. Sixth patriarch is almost called like the second Buddha in Mahayana Buddhism. And he's very famous, not only famous, but he is the beginner of Zen Buddhism. Of course, we can go back to Buddha himself and then Dharma, but it's said by many people that the sixth patriarch is the really the beginner of Zen Buddhism or Zen Buddhism. So the famous story goes this way. He was just ignorant and he was not a teacher. And he just came to the patriarch, and the fifth patriarch, Hongyin, the Buddhist monk, of course, the fifth patriarch, instantly came to know that he was not only brilliant, but really awakened person, Huaneng. But there were lots of people who were striving to know more about Buddhism and try to awaken. So he just put him into a kitchen, and Huaneng was always just working there and doing chores near for the temple, the place where there were lots of people. And one night, the fifth patriarch, Hongyin, called Huaneng to his room, and then he taught him the Diamond Sutra, by which Huaneng had a big enlightenment again. And then the fifth patriarch, Hongyin, said to the Huaneng, "Then I want to appoint you to the highest place, the sixth patriarch, the next patriarch after me. But if I do that, a lot of people here will be jealousy and try to kill you. So just get away right now, and with some clothes and this Buddhist stick, which is coming down from the first patriarch." And then he just running away. And there were lots of people next day following him to capture him, and then maybe to trying to kill him. And the first one was Domyong. His name was Domyong, who used to be a general. So he had a very strong physical condition. So that's why he was the first one to almost capture him, Huaneng, and then Huaneng hit his body behind the wreck, behind the rock, and he hit his body behind the rock, and Domyong said, "Please understand me. I'm not here to kill you or arrest you, but I would like to ask you a question. How come you just retrieve your work in the kitchen and some other places of the temple were appointed to be the next patriarch by the fifth patriarch, Hongyin? I would like to know that. I really am thirst to know that knowledge, to know that. I really do." And then Quenun came out from the behind of the rock and he said to Domyeong, the disciple of the fifth patriarch, of course, said, he said, remove the concept of good and remove the concept of the evil also, then what remains in you? Thought himself that that's just my responding mind. When I find hot water hot, it's hot, and when I taste the cold water, it's I know it's cold. And Huineng said that it's that. That is the truth. In other words, the emptiness or the truth is without any concept, intellectualization or your ability for intellectual ability. And there is knowledge or any kind of phenomena that under the condition that there is something that is opposed to the other, good and evil. Evil cannot be there without the existence of good, and good cannot be there without the existence of evil. So everything in the world is phenomenal, just like that, binary opposition. It's binary, dichotomism. It's always in the form of binary opposition, which is dichotomy. And the truth is behind or beyond or beneath that which you can see or taste or even know or think about. So the truth is not this, nor that, and neither this nor this, or and at the same time, both this and this together. In other words, the whole, which is in fact, nothing that exists in phenomena. You cannot find the truth as a phenomenon, but it's always there creating phenomenon. In Christian terms, creator is always there working with you, through you. Now, that's what is pointed by a finger in Buddhism. All talks by masters and so on. Now, we're not talking about Buddhist sutra, but I would like to talk about Jekyll and Hyde, as I said in the beginning. Jekyll and Hyde is a very famous story, and is a short story. It's not even the middle-length novel, but it's shorter than that, which is called a novella. And there, Jekyll is a very decent doctor in the city of London of the Victorian society, which is very conservative society. And so he was respected a lot. And he was bored by that kind of situation, and he wanted to made something for violent challenge or something. So he made a potion by which he can be, by drinking it, he can be Hyde. The name already symbolizes something that is not really proud of. Of course, I would like to talk about this novella, Jekyll and Hyde, later on in more great detail. But and also, I did that, I just mentioned a couple of times. But here, this is the important point in this context, I think. So I am talking about Jekyll and Hyde today again. This Hyde is the result of his experimentation, Jekyll's experimentation, but Jekyll is nobody else than just Hyde. Hyde is another version of Jekyll, so to speak. So good person and then bad person at the first glance, but according to Buddhist truth, or according to not only the Buddhist doctrine, but Buddhist according to Western philosophy already, or really genuine efforts done by human beings to find the truth. It's just not only the theme that you can get from the novella. I mean, let's go over and beyond the theme. It's not just a thematic approach that I'm doing here. It's not just good and evil are there, and Jekyll is higher than Hyde, and we have to try to live like the protagonist Jekyll, but we also have naturally the bad character like that. So we have, like Hyde, so we have to control the side of Hyde. It's not that, but good and evil are not fixed. The concepts of good and concepts of evil are not really there separately, stable, in the stable and fixed situation at all. So at the end of the novella, because Hyde appears again and again when Jekyll does not want to him to appear, Jekyll wants to kill Hyde, and he does. And that is the only way that he can be satisfied, but the result is suicide, because this person is this and this person is this. So I told you the truth is the whole. So this person already has this character, and this person already has this character, and they are mixed. That's what the work of art, the Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, shows. So after reading the novella, I would like to recommend you to just pause for some moments and think about it again. What is it that goes beyond or lies beyond pure and impure, lies beyond good and evil, and so on and so forth. At that moment, you can know that it's the whole. It cannot be expressed phenomenally or conceptually. You cannot perceive it. You cannot think about it, because our thinking is formed only as a binary opposition, this against this or this against this. We cannot think both at the same time. So we cannot be, for example, positive and negative at the same time toward something. And then there are infinite amount of objects out there in the whole world and in the whole universe. So each and every one is just one element of the whole. We cannot think about it, but the whole is the truth. So that's the true self. The true self is always the whole. And then in situation, in particular situation, we decide on doing this and that, discerning between good and evil, discerning between pure and impure, and discerning between right and wrong, and so on and so forth. Accumulated knowledge that we have already throughout the lifespan, or which is phenomenal. Nevertheless, that is not the knowledge that we accumulate in our mind as time passes. It is not discerned by our mind. So that's the true wisdom that we get or we find after we awaken. Awaken to the truth. That's what awakening means and enlightenment means. That's the truth. That's the self, but that can be called truth, God, Buddha, Tao, and everything, because there's no special name for that, like your name or anybody else's name that expresses that person's character, or that just that pointing that person. Why don't we have some moments meditating on that kind of mind? And then our mind is calming down and we feel something, some mood or something like that after the reading of the novella. But also, it's not that serious because it's not the story of yourself, because it's the story of Jekyll and Hyde, which is made, of course, the fiction, but whether it's non-fiction or fiction, it's the story of somebody else. So it's not directly affecting you. So you have a room for thinking about what can be called the truth. Just calm down and spend some time not thinking about any kind of theme, trying to find the main idea that the novella gives you. Then your mind cannot find the truth right away, phenomenally, just as you look at something. But you feel something. That's what we call the sublime in critical terms of for criticism of literature and film. I don't mean you can find the truth right away and be awakened right away after reading the novella, but as you go on to read more and more novels or poetry and see masterpieces of the film, then your mind is going to be closer and closer to the truth, which is beyond the phenomena, not approachable by any theme. So it's called the emptiness of this and this and all of it. In other words, the fullness, emptiness is fullness. That is the truth. Thank you very much. I'll see you next time.